So, punk, where's Queen Elsa? You were the last ice block she made, so now it's time to talk. Playing it cool, huh? Well, we have ways of getting you to sweat. Ha! Now you're feeling the heat, so I ask you again, where is Elsa?
What'd he say?
Nothing. Turns out water doesn't have a memory. Or a voice. Or honestly anything that helps us solve this case. It is literally just water. Hello, Internet! Welcome to Film Theory, where it's January, and that means it's time to YouTube and chill. Since it's too warm in Southern California to build a snowman, whether I wanna or not, I have to find other ways to celebrate this time of year, so I'm cranking out a sequel of my own on Frozen 2. Just as silly, but somehow less of a cash grab than Disney's version. Yes, I am ready to break the ice to talk about the most anticipated animated sequel of all time, with the most blatantly merchandisable costume changes in Disney history. And in case you're wondering, yes, there will be spoilers. So if you don't want to hear the ending, you're going to want to put this video on ice and go watch the movie already. Or, in other words, go get it over with. Now, despite the opening of this video, I'm not actually going to talk about the big theme of this movie, which is water having memory. That's actually a theory for another day. No, instead today, I'm actually turning back to Frozen 1 to address the famous adage from Elsa.
The cold never bothered me anyway.
I don't know if you've heard this one, guys, but the cold never bothered Elsa anyway. Apparently, that's their reasoning for her walking around on mountaintops in silk organza gowns that are easy to mass produce for the children of the world. In one of her most famous lines from the most famous song in the movie, Elsa lets us all know that part of her power set is that she's impervious to how cold her ice castle is. Not only that, but she walks around in the snow and has a gown with a very chilly looking neckline, but it doesn't seem to matter because none of it can affect her. Seems like a very clearly defined power set. I can respect that. And then you fast forward to Frozen 2 where, they throw all of it out the window. In Frozen 2, we have this massive climactic moment near the end of the movie where we see Elsa freeze solid. What? We just went over how Elsa can't be hurt from the cold, how she's literally swimming in the Arctic Ocean and walking around in this permafrost forest for days in a jacket that's perfect for your next trip to Walt Disneyland, by the way. And when we see her defeated, it's by freezing her to death? Not only is it a blatant ripoff of the climax of the last movie where Anna froze to death, but it just doesn't make sense with Elsa's power set. The cold doesn't bother her. So you know what? The question I, as a theorist watching this movie, have today, well, there are just so many questions, but the question I want to ask today is this. How cold does it have to be to bother Elsa? Clearly, she's not immune to freezing, so what temperature does she freeze at? What is actually going on in this scene? Where is the temperature that we get ourselves a nice Elsa-cole? Now, in case you didn't feed the beast of the Disney sequel machine, or your memory of this movie is foggy, or you just checked out after the words North Oldra and Atahalan were repeated like 47 times in this movie for four-year-olds, Elsa winds up in this chilly little predicament after embarking on a quest at the behest of, well, almost nothing. Some spirits who are whispering to her or something, and almost killing her entire kingdom, but they're not the same spirits who are trapped in the misty wood. It's super confusing, really inconsistent, and not that well written, okay? I gotta get that off my chest. Anyway, she journeys around the north to claim her place as the ultimate ice queen. She abandons her sister, who clearly has PTSD from the last movie, and is angry about being left alone on this journey, which is a plotline that never gets resolved. Fantastic. She rides a horse mermaid hybrid up to the North Country and forgets about Kristoff along with the rest of the cast and crew of this movie, who is left alone to sing an 80s inspired power ballad. The real theory here is whether Disney knew how badly put together this movie was, but I really don't need to get myself started on that. Long story short, what you need to know for this theory is by the end of the movie, Elsa finds herself in the North Country in a dark, mysterious ice cave of self-discovery. She falls a long distance into it. That's it. She freezes. Eventually, she gets thawed by the power of who even cares anymore. Let's pretend for the sake of this theory that they were trying to make a movie with logical cohesion and address how the heck a literal ice queen could possibly freeze to death. Is there an actual scientific explanation here, or was someone just banking on a little too much Disney magic? If we're trying to figure out how chilling it needs to be for Elsa to freeze, we need to get some perspective on temperatures that we're dealing with throughout these movies. We know that Elsa has no problem surviving the cold in the movie's two primary settings, air Arendelle and the Northern Forest, as well as most of the other time that she spends in the Northern Sea and Atuhallin. How cold are these places, and how much colder is it when Elsa actually winds up freezing? Arendelle, as you might already know, is a cross between Arendal and Bergen in Norway. Arendelle for its namesake, and Bergen for its architecture and scenery. We discussed this in our previous little Frozen theory about the fact that Anna and Elsa shouldn't be biological sisters, which, in case you're interested, you can catch up on here if you missed it. Since that theory, Disney's released more information about Arendelle, including a map shown in Frozen Fever, which we can then cross-reference with the geography of Norway. Since the only real feature here is the forked rivers, I searched for similar geographic areas in Norway and found Alesund, an area that lined up almost perfectly with a little map manipulation. The historic highs and lows for Alesund in the fall, which is when the movie begins, is 7.7 to 12.2 degrees Celsius, or 46 to 54 degrees Fahrenheit, which gives us our parallels to Arendelle. Interestingly, Alesund doesn't get very cold. Even in the winter, the highs and lows tend to hover just above freezing, meaning that Elsa's winter wonderland in Frozen 1 would have been much colder than the geographic norm. Additionally, we know Northuldra, the enchanted forest, is within a day or two wagon ride from Arendelle, so we're likely looking at the same temperature averages there as well, with maybe a degree or two of difference. None of the people living there seem to be keeling over from frostbite, so Elsa can just survive there like everyone else. So with those two out of the way, we can actually focus on the more northern locations of the movie, the North Sea and Atuhallin. As Elsa journeys north, again after abandoning her sister in the middle of nowhere, we reach a point where, according to the Frozen Fever map, she runs into the Nordsøen, which is Danish for North Sea. Now, the closest body of water north of Norway on a real-world map is the Norwegian Sea. Interestingly, the name of the Norwegian Sea roughly translates to Sea of the North, so it's a fair stand-in. A bit of research will tell you that the Norwegian Sea, especially the areas close to the coastline that we're dealing with, all max out at about 5.9 degrees Celsius, or 40.8 degrees Fahrenheit, which is not exactly prime surfing temperature. Yearly minimums of 1.3 degrees Celsius, or 36.2 degrees Fahrenheit, are reported, so waters that are just barely above freezing, making this some seriously cold water and easily enough to kill a normal person in a matter of minutes. Interestingly, Elsa's ability to survive in the cold water is perhaps more impressive than her ability to survive in icy castles on dry land, especially when you look at the thermodynamics of a human in water. Falling into water as warm as 68 degrees Fahrenheit, or 20 degrees Celsius, can trigger what's known as a cold shock response, which is the same response you get if your shower suddenly runs cold. You gasp from surprise as a reflexive part of the response, but if you're in a freezing ocean, the gasp forces water down into your lungs. Your limbs are suddenly stunned from the shock of the cold, and you drown almost immediately. If that's not scary enough, or if you manage to avoid the cold shock response, you're still not in for a good time. Even if you're in control of your body to begin with, you lose control of your limbs in about 10 minutes at water 50 degrees or lower, and hypothermia, your internal body temperature dropping below 95 degrees, sets in under an hour, even in the best possible conditions. So for Elsa to survive even minutes in the North Sea waters, she would have had to have been wearing the equivalent of several immersion water survival suits, these big old rubbery looking things. This means that in water where other people are literally paralyzed, and where body temperatures would drop below survivability in a matter of minutes, Elsa's maintaining a normal internal body temperature, and ice surfing with the best of them. It is unbelievable, but it doesn't freeze her. That said, we do have one final location to consider. Atuhallin is the glacier island that Elsa rides to in what seems like a few minutes from Northuldra. Well, initially I wanted to say that this was intended to be Iceland, since the crew from Frozen 2 visited Iceland for geographic inspiration on the movie. It's just too far north. Honestly, the closest coast of Iceland is about 900 miles from Alesund, or any part of the Norwegian coast, which would take a horse, even a magic water horse, like 40 hours of straight running at top speed with no rest. To make our movie travel more realistic, I chose the small island of, can't pronounce those letters, just off the north coast of Norway. There's also possibilities like Bear Island up here, but you know, they all function basically about the same, so just loop them all in as potential Atuhallin stand-ins. Interestingly, all these types of islands tend to have sub-zero temperatures at least 9 months out of the year, meaning that when Elsa likely lands in Atuhallin, the temperature is gonna cause water to freeze directly onto her skin immediately. On top of that, she's facing ocean winds, which will give her a wind chill effect, making it feel even colder for her. Starting at negative 5 degrees Celsius, the average temperature for unpronounceable Norwegian island in November, we can calculate wind chills for 10 to 30 miles per hour, or 16 to 48 kilometers per hour. At these winds, Elsa's feel-like temperature is gonna be about negative 10 degrees Celsius to negative 15 degrees Celsius, or 12 degrees Fahrenheit to 5 degrees Fahrenheit. Even then, there's not even a shiver, so we know even at temperatures significantly below freezing, it is still not cold enough to bother her. So geez, how cold does it need to be? For me, this seemed like a research dead end since we can't even guess about the temperature in the magic cave she's in, how far she's falling, things like that. Heck, inside the cave, it probably should be warmer because she's not subjected to being wet in the wind. That said, there is one thing that we can still speculate about. Elsa herself. What if instead of looking at the air around her, the water that she's impossibly swimming through, all of that stuff, what if we stop comparing her to the way that humans freeze and stop assuming that she's human at all? Instead of assuming that her body functions like a normal person's body, it might make more sense to assume that it functions like the element that she's associated with, ice. Let's take a look at the moment that Elsa freezes again. We see her jump into the ice chasm to follow her past. She falls for a couple of seconds and we see her make a quick landing on her hands and fingertips, like this. A moment later, she hears the truth about what terrible imperialists her people were. We see her start to freeze again at her fingertips and toes, where she landed. Interestingly, in maybe the only scientifically accurate part of this movie, Elsa is freezing like ice. To better explain what I mean here and what's actually happening to Elsa and how her body functions, I'm gonna need to flip it to live action.
Hey, film theorists, Matpat here. Might not look like it because I have less hair up here, more hair down here, but don't worry. That's what happens when you do a charity live stream and put your hair on the line. I'll be back to my old self in like T-minus 3 months, who knows. Anyway, let's do some real world science, shall we? Back in high school, because, you know, this is not child-directed content, only 13 and up here on this channel, you may have done yourself a little experiment in the realm of supercooling. Now, there are lots of YouTube videos out there on this, but I didn't feel like trying to license those because they're expensive and doing science myself is really fun and cool. So anyway, supercooling is just one of those really nerdy things that's fascinating to talk about and even more fascinating to watch in person. And frankly, I just kind of want to try it here since I have the ability and people to film me doing this sort of stuff. So why not take advantage of that? This is also one of those rare things on YouTube that you can actually do yourself. It might take a couple of times to get it right, but the idea is to cool a bottle of water. I'm gonna go get the bottle of water. I'm gonna take off my microphone and then get the bottle. Oh, and it's taped into my jacket. Chris is gonna go get the bottle of water. Thank you, Chris. Hopefully super chilled, ready to be crystallized. Now, the things that you gotta note here are the water, first and foremost, needs to be clean, and it needs to be left very still. Now, this is because in a freezer, water will actually cool below freezing temperatures after a couple hours, but still have a magic area where it stays in a liquid state, because it doesn't have what's called a seed crystal, just a couple of crystal structures in the water that ice can form onto. Now, there's a lot of complicated math that goes behind seed crystals, but for our purposes, we're gonna think about Elsa in Frozen 2 as our little bottle of water here. Probably could have cut out a face and stuck it on here, right? Little Adele Dazeem action figure here. She looks human, right? But in the movie, because she represents the ice element at a molecular level, her body is actually behaving more like freezing water than it does a person. Now, when Elsa falls down in that ice cave and hits the bottom, we suddenly see her whole body crystallize into an Elsa popsicle, kind of like we should see with this experiment. Ready, Dan? Ready, Chris? It's gonna land right here. Ready, 3, 2, 1. And you see it's going. What you're seeing here are water molecules suddenly colliding into each other. A little seed crystal at the top and all the water molecules hitting into it and glomming on, crystallizing into that structure, proceeding all the way down into the bottle until now you have mostly ice with a little bit of water left over. How much? Not a whole lot. Okay, a little bit more than I expected. But you can see that as soon as there was a big impact on that bottle, disturbing the super chilled water inside of it, the entire thing crystallized from the top down to the bottom. Now, this happened because when the bottle dropped onto the table, it sent a shockwave through the liquid, literally forcing water molecules to bump into each other. Through randomness, that extra movement eventually results in water molecules forming something close to the crystal structure of ice. Once that happens, the water suddenly has the seed crystals that it needs, and now more water molecules quickly bump into that seed crystal and align themselves into the proper structure, locking in and freezing almost instantly. In Elsa's case in Frozen 2, we see the crystallization, or nucleation process as it's called, start from her extremities, right? Her feet and her fingertips, where she landed on the ground. But if we were really being scientifically accurate, it would actually start from the top of her head, because that is the end of the shockwave that she experienced from falling. That said, this experiment still provides the best explanation that we have about how an ice queen could freeze to death. She's not a human who controls ice. At a molecular level, she actually is ice herself. In a very roundabout way, this explanation also helps us understand why Elsa is impervious to cold climates, cold air, heck, even brutal wind chills. At a molecular level, Elsa is effectively colder than all of those things. She is super cooled, meaning that they're not cooling her. She is the one that's cooling them. It's science, it's Frozen, and it is super cool. Literally and figuratively. Fascinatingly, even understanding that Elsa's body functions like a supercooled liquid, it still doesn't give us a true sense of her molecular temperature. According to a 2018 study at the University of Frankfurt in Germany, supercooled water can reach temperatures of negative 42.55 degrees Celsius, or negative 44 degrees Fahrenheit, meaning that Elsa has the potential to achieve a massive range of temperatures that would allow her to not only survive the harshest conditions on Earth, but even survive in some places on freezing planets like Mars. And all of this actually makes sense in the context of the movie, for as convoluted as its lore is. Just like the earth giants are made of rock, the wind spirit is literally just wind, and the water horse is water, just ignore that dumb little cute fire lizard, Elsa is made up of the element that she controls. If she truly is the fifth elemental creature, which honestly she shouldn't be because ice isn't an element that's different from water horse over there, but still, if ice truly is a different element in this world, her being super cooled and only freezing from a landing that strikes hard makes perfect sense. So, in an ironic twist, Elsa truly is impervious to cold, as long as she doesn't get smacked too hard by anything. For future reference to all the villains in the inevitable Frozen 3, skip all the swords or guns or flamethrowers or whatever, and just give Elsa a good old thwomp with a frying pan, Tangled style. Or get into a particularly aggressive pillow fight, and frankly, she is done for. Don't tell anyone I tipped you off, though, because if you're a regular viewer of this channel, you'll know that Mickey Mouse and I already have ourselves a, chilly relationship. But hey, that's just a theory. A film theory. And this island that I cannot pronounce, nor can I find any online pronunciation guide, because it's just really hard to find pronunciations for very small areas. Can I just say first, sorry, cut the video. All you travel logs on YouTube right now, why do you not talk in them? There are so many Norwegian travel logs that I've clicked on as I researched this video, hoping that someone will teach me how to pronounce the names of these places. And all of them are just clips set to music with moderate amounts of text on top. It's not helping me. Please teach me how to pronounce these places. Not even Wikipedia has a pronunciation guide for this one. Sorfuglioa. I mean, look at these letters. What am I supposed to do with this? It's a zero. It's an O that's been crossed out. It's like, no. No thank you, O. This is a no pronunciation O. And G's, who even puts a G there? Sorfuglioa. Sorfuglioa. Can someone watching this video in Norway, can you please upload videos of you pronouncing Sorfuglioa and then link them to me on Twitter, MatPatGT, or in the Game Theorist subreddit, and I will try to make a greatest hits compilation of all of them, and we'll do a community tab post or something of it. That'd be great. Please teach me how to pronounce Sorfuglioa. Cut.